Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first workshop of the ARC 4058 Fundamentals of Digital Design for FIU. This is going to go over making a title block and inserting the images that you should have already drawn and take pictures of. So to start, what you're going to need just kind of before you do any of this is downloading AutoCAD 2024 or Rhino 7. As well as, I have them off here to the side on my second screen, I have my two images, as well as the FIU Architecture logo. It's transparent. You can find it by Googling FIU Architecture, and it's one of the transparent PNGs. You have to save it in order for it to retain its transparency. But yeah, let's get started. So I'm starting completely blank from a new file. And first thing I'm going to do is just kind of define my paper size. I'm going to start it off in model space, but then we'll work in paper space afterwards. So I'm making a rectangle. The rectangle is going to be 17 inches wide and 11 inches tall. And then I'm going to select that boundary, type in offset, and then my offset distance is going to be 0.25. a quarter inch in, and then it's going to ask me what side I want my offset to be. So I'm going to choose on the inside. And then we can escape out of that command. I'm going to select the inner border. I'm actually going to do explode. This will, instead of having it be like the outer border where it's all one big rectangle, it's going to split it up into four separate lines. Then I'm using the handout on my second screen as reference. I'm going to then copy. I'm going to select the line on the right side, and I'm going to copy it. I'm going to select the base point, and then I'm going to move out in the direction I want it to go. And then from the handout, it shows that the entire title block is going to be 1.75 by 10.5. So I'm going to copy it 1.75 inches to the left, and we have our first copy for the left side. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to select the top line, grab one of its control points, and then move it over to the other one. And it kind of seems weird to do, but it's so that I can then make another line that's just small. This way I can actually copy it down to be the dividers for each side. So I'm going to do copy again, and then I'm going to go from top to bottom. So that's what it's set up as on the handout. But from top to bottom, I mention how tall each segment is, and I'm going to select the base point, go down a little bit, and then do 1.5 inches. And then I'm going to escape, selected, copy. The next one is 1.75, escape, copy. The next one is the notes section, which is 3.75. And then this one, these next few are going to be 0.5. So I'm actually going to do it in, I'm not going to escape out of the command this time. So I'm going to do 0.5. And then I'm going to do 1, which is 0.5. plus 0.5, and then I'm going to do, oh, wait, actually, my mistake, I forgot that it goes from your last one, so you can, instead of doing that, you can just copy, go down to do 0.5 again, and then you can do copy. And then another way, if you realize that you have a lot of copies that you can do very quickly, you can actually use the snapping, that's this green rectangle, snap it to the piece above and click it and then bring it back down, because we know that this distance is half an inch. And then you can just keep on going to the one that you make until you're done. However, we actually went too far because the last one is 1 inch tall. And we can also confirm these distances by doing DI, distance, and you can I recommend always having snaps on just so that you know you're getting the right distance. This is one, that's 1.5, so this middle one is 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, and so on. Next are the vertical lines for the notes section. Now these, you'll need a different kind of O snap. It's the object snap. You'll need midpoint. And for this one, I draw a smaller line vertically this way. And then I'm going to move it to the right side edge. And then, yes. When you have overlapping lines and features, you can't really tell, but there are two lines here, but there are. And the order that you can place them is the order that you draw them. So because I drew the smaller line first, I can select it over the big line. But if I drew it in the other order, where if I drew the small line and then the big line, I wouldn't be able to select the small line anymore because of the selection order. For that, you're going to right click, go to Object Snap Settings, and then on the top tabs up here, you're going to go all the way to the right for selection cycling. And then you're going to enable selection cycling. It's a feature that Rhino already has enabled, so it might take some finding if you're more proficient in that. But you're going to select your smaller line. You're going to move it a quarter inch. And select it. You're going to move it. And then you're going to do 0.25. But another way to change the angle, because sometimes the angle settings might not be turned on. I realized I didn't have it turned on when I started this command, but in case you ever find yourself in the middle of a command like this, you can often hit tab, and then because I want to move it at over here, you can see it changing 180 degrees. I'll go 180 degrees. That's hitting tab in order to change the different boxes. I might have forgotten to mention it when drawing a rectangle, but when you're drawing stuff and it gives you these values, you can hit tab to switch between setting these values. So I can set it to 12 by 13 and stuff like that. So then we're going to copy this two times. So we're going to select the base point as one behind it and then kind of hop and jump. And now we have the basic layout of our title block. But now we still need to label everything. And to do that, we're going to go up here to the text command. I prefer for these kinds of things to just use single line text, but if you're using multi-line, then if you're gonna write something that has multiple lines in it, multi-line text acts more like a text box in other programs like Word or Photoshop. We're going to select a starting point. Right now, we can just select wherever, specify a height. I specify these heights in the handout, so we're going to go, we're going to do the 0.5. Actually, no, we're going to start from top to bottom, like we did the other side. So we're going to start with select a point. Actually, my mistake. We're doing multi-line text first because this is the information that's about the class. So we're going to specify the first corner and just kind of do a drag and drop box type. And then we're going to do ARC 4058 fundamentals of digital design, drop down all 2023, and then drop two down instructor Colin Neely. You can change the scaling of this and the tabs for, just kind of making sure that everything fits. And then up here at the top, where this drop-down box is, this is where you can change the height. Now, because of the size of the text and the text box, I found that a 0.11 inch, oops, It's a little off and janky, but I felt like it fit better than 0.1. You'll have to select all of your texts, or you can do it before you write it. 0.11. And then you'll have to change this to bring digital design back to that second line. And then you can bring that over here. You can select the top left drag point in order to kind of line it up. I don't specify like an exact distance that you have to put it at. You can just kind of make it look nice as long as it starts in the top left. Then you'll be good. You can either have it all uppercase like it is in the example, or you can have it regularly done. And then we're going to do single lines from now on because nothing should be multi-line after this. So then we're going to do notes. So we're going to do a single line, and then we're going to specify the height. And on the PDF for notes, I specify it at 1/16 of an inch. Specify the text rotation, 0, that's the default, and then it'll be notes. And these are the notes that if me or the TA decide to give you back, then that's where we'll put them. You can hit escape to leave, and then take that drag piece again and just kind of place it. Oh, yes. So if you're looking to play stuff, often you might accidentally run into the program snapping for you. So like when I was moving it over, I was moving it very close to this line, and you'll see that green triangle pop up right here. That's the midpoint snap. And it's kind of saying, hey, you look like you want to put it next to the midpoint. Why didn't I put it there for you? And then you'll click, and it doesn't go where you want to go. So you turn off your snaps there. It's that or F3, although I prefer pressing the button because not all of us have the function keys, and you kind of put it up there. And then one thing that we can do is that on the PDF, I noticed that not only are notes 1/16, but also scale, name, date. Oh, date is actually labeled as 1/18, but that's a mistake. It should be 1/16. But date and grade and title sheet. So we're actually gonna copy them, and we're going to put our snaps back on so that we can snap at the top left here. And this means that we can now snap at the top left so that the spacing is kind of equivalent. So this is gonna be your scale, this is gonna be your name, this is gonna be your date, your grade, your sheet title, and your page. So yes. Sorry, I thought I miscounted for a sec. So then you're gonna double click scale, name, date, grade, sheet title, or sheet name. And then sheet number. So now that we have those, we can do another single line text. Click over here, specify the height. Now the rest of the heights are 1/8 inch. So we do 1/8, rotation angle 0. And then we're going to start with scale. Now the scale for this should be 1:1, although the scale might change for future assignments. Your name, I'm going to put in Jane Doe, because that's an example name. Actually, no. What we're gonna do is instead of writing it out in here, we're gonna do the same thing where we're gonna place it at a pretty good space where it's kind of left, line it up with wherever it fits best. And then we're gonna select it, copy, and then do the copy to every single one. I'm gonna go a little faster because we've kind of done it before. This last one is going to be half an inch, so we can just do single line text, specify point, 0.5, rotation angle, and then A-1 for half inch text. Escape out of that, and then kind of want to place it in the in center here. Sheet name, digital. Actually, we can just do DHD, digital hand drawings. A1, assignment 1, DHD, digital hand drawings. However you want to title it, as long as it's readable. Grade, you're actually going to leave blank because that's for me and the TA. Date, August, I think it's t the yeah, it's the 25th. 25th. 2023. And then name, Jane Doe. And now we have the title block set up. We are missing one step, which is putting the FAU architecture logo in. And so we're going to go to our downloads where we got the transparent image. I'm going to drag it here. We're just going to drag and drop for this one. Specify the point, scale factor. I believe one works. Yeah, one. You can just keep it. And then it's going to be black because AutoCAD by default doesn't do transparency immediately. You have to select the image and then you'll do background transparency and you'll get rid of the transparency. But we also have this white border around it. So this is going to show up when we plot it. So what you can do is in the Insert tab, you go to Frames Vary, and instead just do Hide Frames. So the frame is still there, you can still select it to move it, but it just won't be visible unless you're trying to see it. So I'm just going to grab it from relatively in the middle. I'm not going to do. Actually, I will. I'll show you how to actually center it. The way to fully make sure something's centered, if it's two rectangles, is you can actually draw a diagonal from each corner, and then draw a diagonal from each corner here, and then you use the O snap midpoint, which is sometimes on by default and sometimes it's not, but you can select this drop down and select midpoint. And then you'll select the green triangle, and then you'll just line it up to the green triangle of this one. And then you can delete the diagonal lines, and then it is centered. So now we have our title block finalized, and this is, you can save your file to be just this. Sometimes people like to just move it to 0, 0, just so that it's. So it's just kind of easy to insert. You don't accidentally get some. Sometimes you can get offsets when you try and insert it into other files based on the origin point. So some people like to just have the bottom left be at 0, 0. Sometimes it doesn't matter, sometimes it does. But yeah, it's just best practices to get in the habit of. So we have our title block, and now we're going to move into inserting our images. Now, I pre-photoshopped these images, so I already know that they're natively 5-inch by 5-inch. So I'm going to insert them, specify scale factor of 1 and a rotation of 0, and they drop in. However, if your image, say your image isn't at a perfect 5x5 and it's maybe a little bigger, maybe it's not even a square, maybe it's like, you know, I don't think I can stretch it like you could, on Photoshop, but if it were bigger, then what you can do is you can draw a rectangle. I'm going to turn off snaps so that it's just freer. Draw a rectangle, make it 5 inch by 5 inch. And then you're going to kind of place your image in it. Like, imagine if this eye-looking thing in the center, if that was my image and I wanted to get rid of everything around it, I would put it there, just making sure that I can still kind of see the border here. So imagine if that was my image. I can then select the image. It might be hard to see because of the font, not font color, because of the layer color. So I'm going to real quick for just a little bit, I'm going to set it to red. It's going to turn everything to red. The way you do that is you drop down the list of layers, select on the color and change it red. It's going to change everything red because we've only been working on one layer. But this just helps us to view the border that we're going to make. So after that, we're going to select our image and then do create clipping boundary. And then we're going to use the 5 inch by 5 inch snaps, the green rectangles, to define that clip area. And you now have an image, and then you can delete the border around it. But now you have a 5x5 image that fits. Turning off the frames, the thing that we did to help the FIU architecture stand out, it might be hard to then, oops, not underlay layers. It might be hard to see when you're moving it because it stops rendering the image when you move it. So you can also choose display and plot frames. So in the model space, you'll see the frames. And then when you move it, you'll be able to see the rectangle that you're moving it to. And then when you plot it, you'll see it differently. So I'm actually not going to use this one. I'm going to bring out my other image. Again, this one is already 5 inches by 5 inches, so I don't need to change anything about the scale or clip it. But I'm gonna bring it in on top of my other one. That way, I move everything just a little bit up, and then I select one. I can move everything down by 270. If you do tab and then set an angle and then tap back, then you're restricted to that angle. So then I'm just gonna place it with some border around that. And then for labeling, it can be as simple as taking one of your texts, copying, and then kind of copying out. So you can do copy, specify a base point, tab, do 270 so that you're restricted to going downwards, and then click. You can also, if you just do this, you can array, which you can do a rectangular array. That'll allow for, if you do your distances as negative, so like say you do -5, it'll go in reverse. But we're actually only going to have one column, and then negative, let's go 0.2 for each of them. And then we're going to have 10 because we have 10 commands. We can also drag to increase the counts here and then do the spacing with the first one. So if you wanted to organize your commands like that, and then they're all going to be, you know, linked together, so then you can explode them to become separate ones that you can then double click and and change. So this first one, offset, billet, chamfer, trim. Now you could either have them all grouped out equally spaced, or you can group them to be closer to each other. Like if you wanted to, if these five were, you know, your other drawing. Another thing you can do is that if you hold down shift, it won't do it immediately. You have to hold it down for like a second, but it'll restrict it to be ortho. That's another way that you can restrict yourself to orthographic modifications. And then this one is going to be copy, array, hatch, arc circle, and then mirror. So now you've got your 10 commands. And then actually, now realizing that they're all still red, we can change that back. I can also delete this. Oop, not that one. We can change everything back to index white, kind of AutoCAD default. And then we can just draw out a little line just to act like a leader. It's almost like we're making manual leaders, which you can do by just clicking on the leader button and then selecting where you want to point to. Select the leader landing, and then you can, you know, I just kind of keyboard smash there, but offset. You can do it either way. If you find it easier to do your leaders like this, go for it. My thing is that because we have multiple things we want to point to, we might want to just kind of make our own. Also, because we have such a copied list, it might just be better to manually do it, but to each their own. So then this is kind of, this is where it starts to hinge on your design, where you find all of the different ways that you used your commands. So, like, say in this instance, I used offset here. It might not show immediately, but when we start to plot it, you'll be able to see. You can also put color into your leader lines if you think that that'll help. I'll view it, you know, I offset inwards to make this. I filleted on these interior edges to, well, I drew a radius, so it's effectively a fillet. I filleted on these interior ones. I chamfered, it's hard to tell because some of the quality, but I chamfered on, I chamfered very tiny just because sometimes you want to have just a little bevel in your, manufacturing, just so that fabricating is easier, but it didn't end up showing very well when I scanned it. Trim is actually used incredibly often here, but you don't have to do it 80 times. You can label it 5 times or 6 times, as long as I know that you used it a bunch of times, where I drew these vertical lines and then I just trimmed away the ones that that were in this geometry. You actually can't see because of my cursor, but I trimmed away where it's blank so that it gave this kind of spatial difference. And then I trimmed away every other one in this area. And then, array, though. Interesting. Array. And then, all right, I meant to put I meant to put array where extend is because I used array here because in order to first make these curves, I actually arrayed them all in the horizontal axis. So these are all arrayed before even I got to trimming them. You know, so all these. And then this one is the extend command. So in this case, I used copy in order to copy these small pieces as well as, I didn't use copy for the small pieces. I used copy for the middle pieces, where I copied them into this kind of axis. And I use the word axis because I'm actually going to skip down to the end. I mirrored this entire image across the diagonal axis. I hatched all of the circles too. Ironically, with the hatch, you can kind of see my my lines a bit easier. I extended these lines that reach this kind of big arc because it was easier to have to draw a line straight through and then to copy it versus trimming. Or it was easier to extend it shorter and then just extend it to the border because it just reaches it. And then arc circle is one of the biggest ones, but I used arc for this piece at the diagonal bottom. It's kind of wave, where it's just three arcs that are connected, but they're going the opposite direction. So now we have everything annotated. We're going to go over printing. So we're going to go to a layout space, and this is what's called paper space. And this is one-to-one, where this is pretty much what's going to be shown. But right now it defaults to, I believe, 8.5 by 11. So we're going to right-click layout, go to page setup manager, and then we're going to modify. Now this takes you up to, it's very similar to like a print function, where we got to set up our plotter, our printer. So I'm going to choose your options. You can do Microsoft Print to PDF, Adobe PDF, but I usually prefer to do DWG to PDF. Just because that's, we're in DWG, so we might as well go to PDF. Your paper size, we're doing 11 by 17. I prefer full bleeds because of if you see this dotted line around, that's kind of like an origin for where the printing, not the printing, yeah, it's where the printing starts. Because of how the rollers have to go through the printer and it's the whole mechanics of the printer. But full bleed allows it to, full bleed means that it goes to the edges. So it starts the origin of the printable space at the edge of the paper, which is very helpful. Plot styles. This is, I believe you should have gone over stuff like this, with plot styles. But I usually prefer monochrome or ACAD. ACAD helps with, it's very similar. It's just that a monochrome is black and white, so it's usually a smaller PDF versus color. We're going to go ACAD. Scale, 1:1, typical. And then layout, that's how it goes. A lot of these should be default, but if you've used AutoCAD before and you might have set something up yourself, it might be different. So then you're going to click OK, and you're going to see that dotted line that I mentioned before is now gone because it's actually at the paper edge, so you don't really see it. And now the entire paper size has changed. So now we're going to, this is our window into the model space. So if you double click it, you can now be in the model. One thing to note is that usually you use double click on the white space to get out of model space, so that now you're messing with the paper stuff again. But it's specifically for zooming, in my opinion, because when you're in model space, you zoom in and you're not zooming into the paper. But when you click out in paper space, you're now back here. However, if you accidentally have your entire screen here and you're just acting in model space, now you don't have a way to click on that white space. So then you're going to go down here to model and you're going to click it, and it's going to say paper again, and you're back into paper space, because you can actually switch into model space and paper space using these. But we're going to stay in paper space. And now we're going to right click on object snap settings and go to snap and grid, and we're going to turn snap on. And this is because this isn't object snap, it's grid snap. However, when we want to click and drag the viewport, we're going to be dragging it to the edge. There isn't snapping on the edge of the paper, so we have to actually use grid snap to snap to what we know to be the edge of the paper. And then now our paper is 11 by 17 and printing all up the model. So now we can double click to go into here. We can use this grid to turn off the grid, this grid icon to turn off the grid. And then we can zoom in, but instead of having to worry about like zooming in and out, we can do the zoom command and then do window. And then because we have the window selected, it's not letting me snap to that, but maybe it'll let me. You can do zoom and then extents, where because we have nothing else in the model space, we can do zoom extents. We can also do zoom object, I believe. If we select this, which we know to be the paper border, and then press enter, it'll zoom us to that. But now you'll see at the bottom right, it's 1:0.992369. That's just because of how it's almost like a scale to fit. So we're going to click 1:1, and it's going to zoom in just a tiny bit so that now that 11 by 17 is at the edge. We're going to click P. We don't have to change the name on everything, but all of our settings should be there. We click OK. I'm going to go to downloads. Sometimes you might not have this. And that's the case, you'll have to drop down and try and find it. I just kind of saved it, because when you do find it, you can do add current folder to places so that you save it. I'm just putting it in downloads because that's kind of where I mainly work. It's not the brightest way to do it, but now you have your stuff, and this is what you're going to submit. Thanks. And yeah, that's the end of the AutoCAD portion. Now we're going to do kind of the whole thing again, but in Rhino. And I'm going to go through making the title block a little faster, and I might use a couple things that I find to be faster. However, you'll notice that it's effectively the exact same thing of making boxes, where, you know, rectangle 11, it changes the box with you. It doesn't match your corner. So let's do 17, actually, width by 11. Select it. We're offsetting it. All the commands that I type, you'll see up here. Typically, AutoCAD's command line, we go to model space. It's down here, but you should get in the habit of looking up here, because now it gives you all of the different options for offsetting. So we're going to click on it, because you can actually click on it too. 0.25 for distance, go inside. And then a shortcut is that you can do control and shift to select. So this is still, we haven't exploded it yet. This is still one rectangle, but we can control shift to select a specific part. And then we have this gumball. Now, if I look at it in 3D, the gumball has, if I select anything, the gumball has three things. It has squares. This is for scaling. So it scales in that direction. It has circles. So this is for rotating. And then it has arrows. And this is for moving. It's moving, scaling, and translating. And moving, scaling, and rotating. You also have extruding, but we're going to work on that when we get to 3D. But that's just a real rough estimate of what the gumball can do. But one of the things that I really like about it, if you don't see it, actually, if you don't see it, you can activate it on this bottom row where it says grid snap, ortho, planar, gumball. And then down here are your snaps. But you can select gumball to activate it. You can either drag it, or if you click it, you can put in a value. And if it's positive, it'll go in the direction of the arrow, and if it's negative, it'll go in the opposite direction. This is very handful for exact dimensioning. So, like, I'm going to, if I wanted to move it 2 inches to the right, I just put 2, and now it's moved 2 inches to the right. And because it's still attached to that rectangle, it followed with it. But if I were to hold Alt, which is a very common thing in Rhino or Photoshop, where if you hold Alt, you can actually, if I were to just drag it, you can make a copy, which is very helpful for making copies at a certain distance, such as if I wanted it to go left, I go negative and then 1.75 for the width of the title block. Now, I can't do that for the top piece, but what I can do is just snap it to the edge points. So I have a small piece here. Here's another selection menu because they are default with Rhino. And you can click and then it'll be negative 1.5 inches. And then we can click this, hit Alt, negative because we're going down 1.75, Alt and click negative 3.75. Alt, negative 0.5. And then as we get to this part, you might have noticed as we do this that when you do press click, it actually saves your last it saves your last number for moving. So we can actually just hit enter for this again. Alt and click, enter, alt and click, enter, and then alt and click, enter. We don't have to do the last one because it's 1 inch instead of half. And then we're going to do something very similar to AutoCAD where we just took a line and wrote it in the middle. Often I just remember to click on here, it's polyline. You can also type PL or line. I'm going to do move. I'm going to move it all the way to the right. And then instead of having to move it and grab it, I'm just going to use the gumball minus 0.25, hold just to move the original one, so now there's nothing overlapping. And then I'm going to Alt click and then enter, and then Alt click enter. So now we've got the basic layout done of it, and we're going to do text. Text is something a bit, it's slightly different in from AutoCAD and Rhino in the sense that it gives you more options up front, but then effectively it's the same. What I like to do is actually, I believe it's inch decimal. It'll start you off in foot inch architectural because that's how we annotate stuff. However, if you'll notice 0.125 inch, if I just do notes, it'll actually be huge because it's working in its own paper space already. So if we change it to inch decimal, there's a foot decimal. 0.25. There's always a weird thing when it comes to, oh yeah, right, model space scale. So this is what we changed to 1, and then now it's going to be the correct size. So I think even in foot inch architecture, yeah, you'll see foot inch architectural, the model space scale is 96. So an eighth inch is actually going to be 96 times the size it is. So in whatever style you choose, because styles are kind of like the templates, I typically go decimal just because decimals are more accurate than fractions, but you just set scale to 1 And then it, if you'll notice, it goes back. So 0.125 is 1/8 as a decimal. So we're actually going to keep this as 1/8, just kind of write it down, because we're not going to use 1/8 quite yet, but we are going to use 1/16. And so I'm actually going to take this text, and because I don't want to mess around with the model space every time, I'm going to hold Alt and just drag it up here to make copies. I can actually do that all the, like, I can do as many as I want, but I'm just going to stick with one. This is going to be the class information. So this is where, this is kind of like why I chose the decimal one, where I do 0.11. ARC 4058, fundamentals of, and then it's kind of hard to explain text boxes in Rhino, so I just kind of go the basic way of doing it myself, digital design, because it's almost like this is single line, but if you wanted to do multi-line, then the way that it does its spacing is different from the way that AutoCAD does its spacing. So I just find it easier, if I am going to annotate multi-lines at all, to just accept where I'm going to do my breaks and do it manually. Although it's kind of rare that it actually comes up. Instructor, Colin Neely. And then, so if I grab the green arrow, it's only in the X direction. I mean, the Y direction. And if I grab the red arrow, it's only in the X direction. But if I grab this plane that's right here, kind of in the middle, it shows both red and green. I can move it in both directions. It's kind of like dragging. So I'm just going to drag it there. Then I'm just going to copy this over. Actually, then what I can do is I can copy this. And because I'm using the green arrow to copy, I can just make sure that it's always aligned left. And I did this because we're going to choose a different font size now. We're going to do notes. So this is 1/16. You can just put in a fraction, and when you click away, it's going to give you 0.063. That's 1/16 in decimal. Notes. And then you'll see the new one versus the old one here. You click OK. And then now we can do the same thing where we copied and did all of its, just copied to everything, changed them. You've got scale, name, date. All right, I forgot to add colons. And then grade, sheet name, sheet number, and then now we can do the 1/8 text, where now we can do move, and then if we hover over the text, you'll notice that it actually has a bounding box. We can choose the top right. And then we can align it to the left side of the bounding box of this text so that we know, I'm putting it in notes, but it doesn't actually need to go with notes. So we're moving it next to scale, put it the bounding box, give it some space just so it's not butting up and kind of looks good at a distance. So maybe I'll bring it just a little lower, kind of like towards the middle. And then we can copy it from the top left of the box to all the other ones, not to grade because we don't need it. And then we can do scale, that'll be 1:1. Name, Jane Doe. Due date, or just date, I'm doing today's date, 25th. Grade, that's for us, so that's empty. Sheet name, assignment one, digital hand drawing. And then I'm just going to drag this down again to make a copy. A-1, and then we know that this is 0.5 inches. And then one of the things that also helps is that you can actually, if you hover over the dot, that control point, this is when you can move it in all directions, but also include snaps. Snaps are slightly different in Rhino, where instead of having the little diagrams, instead it kind of snaps you, and then it says end int. So this is an endpoint, where it's the endpoint of this line, and it's the intersection point of this line and this line. And an interesting command that is sometimes a little hard to work with when it's always on is center. It's CEN down there. So if I'm going to make, if I'm just make a real quick reference rectangle, so now I have a, I not only have this line, I also have the rectangle. I can click and drag it, and if I bring it close to the edge, it snaps to the center. And I can let go to apply it, and then I can get rid of our reference curve. And now we have all the text laid out. Next, we can do the image, where we bring in the FIU architecture. And this is where I think it's a lot different from Rhino and AutoCAD, because AutoCAD is mainly for drafting. However, Rhino can do everything from drafting to modeling to texturing to rendering. So it actually doesn't know how you want to insert your image, because you can do it as, you know, the surrounding environments, the materials, a wallpaper if you want. So you actually just choose picture, and then you do your corner, and then you actually, that's when you give it a scale. Sometimes it's good, the other time you can just do one, but this is kind of where it doesn't take into this is where it's not like AutoCAD, where it doesn't take into account the original I exit out of the command for a sec. It doesn't take into account the original size. So for this one, we're just kind of going to guesstimate. But what it does do is that it doesn't have to deal with the borders that we had to mess with in AutoCAD. It also automatically applies transparency. So we're going to do a similar thing that we did before, where we make a reference rectangle, and then we kind of snap it to center. And as long as it looks good, it looks good. If you want to make it bigger, you can select it and then drag these. However, I obviously, you don't want it to be stretched, so you don't want to drag just one of these. You can hold shift and it'll drag both. It'll drag to scale. Another thing you can do is you can click it if you wanted to make it exactly two times as stretched, and then you make it exactly two times, then it's kind of the same thing. Or you can hold shift and click, and say if I wanted to scale it back down 0.5, it scales it to scale. That's kind of an intro to Gumball scaling and Gumball transformations. But now, you know, we have our complete title block. So now, similar to the FIU image, we're going to drag and drop the images. We have a picture, and then these, because we actually know the length that we want, we can just say 5, and it'll make it a 5x5. We can drag and drop the other image, 5 and 5, and then we have both images up. And because they're actually geometry, we can snap them to each other's center, and then use the green arrow to make sure that they're aligned, select both of them, and we can use the gumball to just position them however we want, whatever fits best. Or if you really want them to be centered, we can do another reference rectangle here, just for the model space per se, and then just kind of assign it to the center of that reference rectangle, and then we can use selection cycling to select the smaller one that we just made and deleted. Then we can select our text and then do a very similar thing of just holding Alt and then click, left click, and then unclick, declick, release, you know, click, release, click, release, click, release. And then you can select all of them, click, and then release. I'm not going to go through annotating them all because, you know, I went over that for the AutoCAD portion, but it's effectively the same thing of it'll snap. It might want to snap to the stuff, but, you know, you just draw your line and then you select your lines. And the difference here also is that, like, I'm just kind of annotating here just to show, but when you want to repeat a command, you can either press enter or you can actually right click. And sometimes people think, oh, right click is how you get to the options, but then they start doing their most previous command. You can also hit shift to become angle locked. Angle locking here is different, where you can get 45 degrees too. You can also change some settings, but that's more advanced than I think we're ready to get to right now. But yeah, and then you start doing your annotations, and then eventually it'll look kind of like this, but all in black, because it's kind of like light mode and dark mode. Rhino works with black as it's black. However, now we get to printing it. And if you remember, we had to go through the whole layouts and page setup manager and all that. In Rhino, something you can just do is if you do Control P. Another thing is if you just left click on this printer icon, Control P, and you're in a print format. You can do Adobe PDF. You can do a Rhino PDF or a Microsoft printed PDF. I kind of prefer Adobe PDF through Rhino. It's, again, it's kind of, you work with what you got. You can click on window to set the window. And this is what it's very good to work in, knowing what your paper size is going to be, because this, you press enter to define your print window, and then you have scale to fit. But because it's also centered on your paper center, you can actually choose to scale it at different scales. So this is what I meant by like liking Rhino more, in the sense that you can change whatever scale. Like, you can have it be a preset scale, or you can actually set your own scale if you have some weird reason to do so. But now we're going to do 1-to-1. It's going to default to scale to fit, because it's going to try and fit in that extra outer line of the paper size, but we don't actually care about it because we know that it's going to be 11x17. So we can do 1-to-1, and then we have all of our stuff. The next few things are about, you know, printer margins, where you can actually change out the line types and line widths here. If all of the line weights are set to default, so I can set a default line width of like 2 if I wanted, and everything's going to be super thick, or hairline, and everything's going to be like a pixel wide. I typically like to keep it at like 0.13 or 0.18. It's fundamentally the same thing, but when you're working on bigger sheets, it sometimes helps to do it. And then for visibility, you can have different things like showing background color. This is where you kind of get into stuff that's more for rendering. Lights, clipping planes, stuff that we're going to learn about eventually. And then printer details, you don't really care about scaling. Yeah, and then you set your paper size up here. I think either Tableau or Ledger is 11x17, but they also just have an 11x17 option. You choose port, you choose landscape. And then raster or vector, this is kind of like why I explained raster and vector to all of y'all, because typically, because we know that we're going to be printing this eventually, or you know you want to print it, you'll do raster. But if you're actually working, say, in like graphic design, or you're doing diagrams, you might want to do vector output instead, so that you can input it into stuff like Illustrator and work with it as paths instead of pixels. And you just do print, and it prints it, gives you a little dialog. Let's do downloads, Rhino, Shadow Block. Prints it. Okay, I'm back. So it turns out, don't actually use Adobe PDF. I swear I've used it before, but it just crashed Rhino like twice. So actually just use Rhino PDF. You can also, another way, actually I'll go over that later, do Rhino PDF. If Rhino PDF crashes your computer, do Adobe PDF. Sometimes it's exactly the same thing. You set your window, set your scale, other visibility stuff. But for some reason, Adobe PDF crashed my computer. You might have to do with my Adobe license or something. You can also do Microsoft Print to PDF. I was right, it's tabloid. So if you choose tabloid, that's 11 by 17. So it should be safe to do Microsoft Print if you have that. A last-ditch often, or last-ditch effort, would be image file, where you actually just, instead of doing a PDF, you actually just export it as an image, like a PNG. I find that image file is one of the best things to do for renders or printing to... not rendering, because that has its own thing, but like printing out a viewport of what you're looking at for sketching. And if you're doing like concept 3D modeling, you can make a PNG or a JPEG of what your computer is looking like without actually needing to like do a screenshot. But yeah, so now we have both, and if I go to this, another thing I noticed is that if you were following along with the exact buttons I was pressing, I actually misclicked. And so for doing the borders, what I said earlier was to go to insert and drop down, and I clicked on this one, but I meant to click on this one where it's display but don't plot, because this one is display and plot. Because when that happened, I didn't notice that I did plot the border, but then when I replotted it, it got rid of it. So you just do the hide, you do hide or the don't plot option for it to be transparent. So this is what we got out of AutoCAD, and this is what we got out of Rhino. The biggest differences are the spacing between the lines, as well as the FAU architecture image, just because we scaled it. We did that a bit more freehand. That's kind of just personal preference. I'm not gonna rag on anyone for having just a little difference in scale of the logo, but everything else, the image from Rhino also looks a little thicker. That's because AutoCAD automatically does those hairline lines, whereas for Rhino, we were able to change it, and I just changed it instead of hairline to 0.25. Practically unnoticeable unless you have them all right in front of you and you're flipping back and forth. But yeah, so that's assignment one, and yeah, hope you learned.